morning and welcome to Christ Central Church. My name is Timothy Price. I'm one of the pastors here. Really glad that you decided to join us this morning. Church, I know that virtual worship is tough, and I'm so glad that you have continued to make it a priority to carve out this one day in your week to sing, to pray, and to be fed by God's Word. If you're new here, welcome. I hope you'll continue to join us. We are truly happy that you're here and love for you to become a part of our little church family. We just have one announcement this morning. In spite of this pandemic, we still have a lot going on here at Christ Central, and our various ministries are continuing to offer safe ways for us to gather. And so I just want to put those before you, invite you to join if you feel comfortable. We have events like Central Kids at Pelican Snowballs, 20s and 30s at Maple Views Farms, Women's Outdoor Movie Night, Central Students Rave Crave, which I have no idea what that is, and more. So you can learn more on our website. Please, if you are comfortable and you are longing to be with someone else from this body, I'd encourage you to take advantage of these opportunities. That's our only announcement this morning. At this time, we would normally greet one another in person, but as has been our custom in this season of social distancing, I want to encourage you to send a text message or two. Let somebody know that you're thinking about them, that you're praying for them, that you miss them. I'll give you a minute to send those texts, and then we'll call you to worship. Amen. At this time, I would like to invite you, if you're able, to stand as we prepare our hearts and our minds for worship. Brothers and sisters, I have no idea what your week has looked like. Maybe it has been really difficult. Maybe you've gotten some bad news. Maybe you're feeling really defeated in this moment. At a minimum, I think for all of us in this pandemic, I doubt your week was easy. Good news is that although our circumstances are all over the place, up and down, highs and lows, our God never changes. He is constant, steadfast, faithful. And the scriptures teach us that his love endures forever. And it's that God who is calling to you this morning, wherever you're at. He's inviting you to come to him and to find rest in him. So I invite you now to listen and respond to our Heavenly Father's call from Psalm 95. He says, "Oh, come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with songs of praise. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods. In his hand are the depths of the earth. The heights of the mountains are his also. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture and the sheep of his hand." Would you pray with me? Father God, we confess that we are all over the place. Our hearts are prone to wander. Our faith is often small, smaller than a mustard seed. Our hope in you comes and goes. But you are faithful. You are trustworthy, and you are true. So, Father, we ask that you would meet us here. Fill us with yourself. Remind us of your goodness and faithfulness to us. I pray these things in Jesus' name.
Lift up your voice and
Be seated. At this time, I want to encourage those with children in your midst to look to our children's worship downloads. Our children's ministry team has been providing some awesome resources for you, and we put those out each week. So if you haven't taken advantage of them, I would encourage you to do so. Really, really great stuff. And as we do each week, we're going to now pray for our children at Christ Central. So I'll begin with the prompt, and then we'll respond together in prayer. So, church, what is our prayer for our children at Christ Central Church? May the word of the Lord grow in their hearts. Amen. We now enter into a time of corporate confession. One of the things that I really appreciate about a corporate confession of sin is that it reminds us that we're not alone in our struggles. We're all sinful. We all struggle to love God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength, and to love our neighbors as ourselves, which is why this confession is corporate. And the beautiful thing is that when we corporately confess, it squashes any sort of hierarchy that we might be feeling, that maybe we're the bad Christians and everyone else, they are the good ones. But rather, the confession reminds us that we're equally in desperate need of God's grace. The way we do confession here at Christ Central is we'll first confess together as one, and then I'll offer some time for private, personal confession. So, church, let's confess our sins together. Gracious God, our sins are too heavy to carry, too real to hide, and too deep to undo. Forgive what our lips tremble to name, what our hearts can no longer bear, and what has become for us a consuming fire of judgment. Set us free from a past that we cannot change. Open to us a future in which we can be changed. And grant us grace to grow more and more in your likeness and image through Jesus Christ, the light of the world. Amen. This time I want to encourage you to reflect on what we've just confessed and spend some time privately confessing your sins. Amen. Church, the good news for you and for me is not only are all of us in need of God's grace, but at the same time, God's grace is available for all who call upon his name. If you put your faith and trust in Jesus Christ, you can rest assured that your sins, past, present, and future, have been dealt with on the cross. The truth is, we need to be reminded of this often, don't we? Which is why each and every week we follow our confession of sin with an assurance of pardon. God's gracious reminder that we have been reconciled to him by the blood of Jesus. And so I invite you now to stand as we are reminded of how we've been raised up in Christ. Here as God speaks over us this assurance of pardon from Ephesians chapter 1. Paul says, "In him, in Christ, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of our trespasses, according to the riches of his grace, which he lavished upon us in all wisdom and insight, making known to us the mystery of his will, according to his purpose, which he set forth in Christ as a plan for the fullness of time, to unite all things in him, things in heaven and things on earth."
Power of sin and darkness. done for me.
Cheer and to die. Straight for
be seated. At this time, I want to invite you to join me as we confess our faith together, as we declare alongside one another what it is that we believe, the good news that has gripped each of our hearts and transformed our lives. So let's confess our faith together using the Apostles' Creed. Christians, what do you believe? I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord. He was conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. As I mentioned at the start of this service, we would love to connect with you. If you're new or if you've been here a while, we'd love to hear from you. And so we have this virtual connection card as a way for you to reach out and let us know what you need, how we can help you, how we can connect you better to our church. And just like when we were meeting together, there's a place on that card for you to share ways that we can pray for you, ways that God is at work in your life. So please fill that out so that we can be praying for you and walking with you in that way. At this time, we transition now to a time of giving. And as we often say, it's as a reminder that giving is an act of worship. It is worship because it flows out of this awareness, recognition of God's generous giving towards us. I do want to remind you all as well that this is not a time for you to purchase God's favor. We cannot purchase his favor. God will not love you any more or any less based on what you do or do not give. God's favor has been purchased for us by Jesus Christ. And I hope that that is as freeing for you as it is for me. In terms of logistics and how to give, you can give online in this season. You can give through our app, or you can mail checks to the church office. At this time, I'm going to pray now. Would you join with me as we pray for this morning offering? Father God, we give you thanks because you have been so good to us. You have given immeasurably, abundantly to us. You gave your one and only Son, Jesus Christ, to us. And Father, would you teach us how to, like you, be generous, to, like you, give sacrificially and joyfully. God, may your generosity poured out on us motivate us to, in turn, be generous to others. God, we give you thanks and praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Morning, church. My name is Aaron. I serve as one of the pastors here. We've now transitioned into a time of congregational prayer. So typically we have a church of the week, and we have a prayer focus of the week, and we also would like to continue to receive your prayer request. So submit those as well. Feel free to share them in the comments, or you can send them in as an email on our virtual prayer tab as well. So today our church is St. Mark AME Zion and Reverend Julian Pridgen. And our prayer focus this week will be our Christ Central Women, so our women's ministry. And so let me jump into a time of prayer and then we'll go into a time of continued worship through the preaching of the word. Lord Jesus, thank you for this morning that we are able to gather. God, we know that you are sovereign over all things, and so all of the feelings and all of the thoughts that we are experiencing through this time of the pandemic that we are facing and all things that are going on in our world, we know that you are not asleep. So God, we pray that you would hear us as we petition that you would just give us comfort and that you would help us to see clearly you and your wisdom and your kindness and your provision toward us. And Lord, we lift up St. Mark AME Zion and Reverend Julian Pridgen and staff, as well as the volunteer staff, congregants, folks who are regular attenders there. God, we pray that you would bless them with a pouring out of your spirit, that as they worship your name and as they preach the word that you've given them through the scriptures, and as they serve in the community, that their impact would be felt, that your presence would be seen, and that your name would be glorified. We pray that you would provide for them the things that they need to do about the ministry and the work that you've called them to do in the city of Durham. We are grateful for their presence. We are grateful that they proclaim your son. And so, God, we ask that you would just continue to bless them. We pray for those who are visiting, that they would see Jesus. And we pray for those who are members and regular attenders, that they would grow deeper in their faith and commitment and mission in the city. Lord, we lift up our women's ministry, Christ Central Women. We pray, God, that they will continue to have rich times of gathering with you. And although COVID has changed some things in how we connect, I continue to pray for new, fresh ideas that they might be able to not only connect with one another, Lord, but to connect with you in your word and growing and growing and growing to the most holy faith as Scripture teaches us, Lord. We pray that they would develop new relationships, that women would meet women who can chat and conversations around things that are common to them. God, whether that be parenting, whether it be work, whether it be relationships, whether it be social life, however you see fit, we pray that those conversations are meaningful and helpful. God, we lift up Christy and the team as they plan, as they prepare, and as they navigate all the things that need to be navigated during COVID and working with virtual church. So bless them, Lord. Keep them and continue to show your grace to the women's ministry in our church. And now, God, as we transition into a time of hearing the word preached, I pray that you would give Evan a sense of your grace. I pray that you'd give him a sense of your provision and wisdom. And as he's been preparing this week to preach your word, God, I pray that he would proclaim the very oracles of God, that our hearts might be challenged in ways, but that we might see comfort, grace, and peace that only you can provide. And we trust you. Bless Evan in this time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Well, good morning. I'm Evan. I'm on staff here at Christ Central as a pastoral resident, and very grateful for the opportunity to be in God's Word with you. If you have your Bibles, would you meet me in James chapter 5? James chapter 5, starting in verse 7, is where we will be this morning. And while you're turning there, just want to let you know we've been walking through a series on the fruit of the Holy Spirit, if this is your first time with us. The fruit of the Holy Spirit is found in Galatians 5, verse 22 and 23, and you find there this list of nine aspects of the fruit of the Spirit: love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. I think I got all of them there. You can find it there, though. This list is not exhaustive. That's why the list ends with, against such things there is no law. But it's also important to understand that the fruit of the Spirit is a unit. It's all in one. That's why Galatians says the fruit of the Spirit is. That when you're talking about the fruit, it's an aspect of the same thing. And it's important to understand that because you can't say that you have one part of the fruit and not another. You can't say, I'm good on love, but I could use some work on goodness. I'm good on patience, but I could use some work on self-control. No, it's a package deal. As you think about the fruit, it's like a prism, and you turn and see it at different angles, but it's all one. So in many ways, the last several weeks, we've been preaching on the same thing with different features. And for me, I get to preach on patience. Patience. Lord, have mercy. Patience. That's a cuss word in 2020, is it not? I mean, there are so many things that are wrong and out of our control, and the refrain has been, be patient. Wait and see. And so many people are tired from it. I know I am. And I feel so inadequate to preach on patience. My wife, she is one of the kindest and most gracious people you'll ever meet. And when I told my wife that I was preaching on patience, she kindly and graciously turned to me and said, how are you going to preach on patience? Because my wife knows me. She knows my many character flaws, and if you were to ask her, what is one of the many character flaws in me, towards the top of the list, she would say, Evan struggles to be patient. I struggle. And you know what? I've been preparing this sermon for weeks now, studying about patience, reading and researching and praying. And you know what? I'm not even more patient. Even after my study, I'm still just as impatient. But what has happened is I have grown in my awareness of how impatient I really am. What's happened for me is I considered godly patience, I have seen more my need for God's grace. Many of us are struggling with patience. And when I think about patience, there's no scripture that better comes to mind on the topic than James chapter 5. So let's stand together if you're able, and let's read James chapter 5, verse 7 through 11, as we consider how do we walk in patience. This is the word of the Lord. Be patient, therefore, brothers, until the coming of the Lord. See how the farmer waits for the precious fruit of the earth, being patient about it, until it receives the early and the late rains. You also, be patient. Establish your hearts, for the coming of the Lord is at hand. Do not grumble against one another, brothers, so that you may not be judged. Behold, the judge is standing at the door. As an example of suffering and patience, brothers, take the prophets who spoke in the name of the Lord. Behold, we consider those blessed who remain steadfast. You have heard of the steadfastness of Job, and you have seen the purpose of the Lord, how the Lord is compassionate and merciful. The very words of our God. Let's pray. Lord God, what a privilege it is to know you and to know your word. Lord, I ask that as I speak to the ear, that you would speak to the heart and transform lives. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight. Oh Lord, our rock and our redeemer. In Jesus' name, amen. You may be seated. A couple years ago, there was a national crisis in the UK. This national crisis was that they ran out of chicken. I'm serious, I'm not kidding. In 2018, KFC, Kentucky Fried Chicken, ran out of chicken. They had to close their almost 900 stores temporarily because they ran out of supplies. There was some kind of delivery issue that they weren't able to get their services together, and so temporarily they had to close their doors, and the citizens lost their minds. I mean, KFC crisis became a trending hashtag on social media. People were actually calling the police to report it as an emergency. It got so bad that the police had to issue a statement telling the public to stop calling them because this is not the kind of emergency that the police deal with. The outrage was comedic in one sense, but the message from the public was clear. You were made for this, so this is what you should be offering the world. A Kentucky Fried Chicken with no chicken is a problem. But even more so a problem, a Christian with no character is even worse. When the scriptures are talking about the fruit of the Spirit, what the scriptures are expressing is, this is what you were made for, and this is what you should be offering the world. That as Christians, you should be expressed in a certain way. That to be a Christian and to not express the fruit of the Spirit is a contradiction in terms. Francis Chan wrote a book on the Holy Spirit called The Forgotten God. And in his book, he highlights the importance of the Spirit-filled life. And he says, God is not just one thing we add to the mix called life. He wants an invitation from us to permeate everything and every part of us. And when we're talking about the fruit of the Spirit, what we're saying is it's an invitation to live a life that's permeated by the presence of God. And to be a Christian and to not have love and joy and kindness and peace is like being like a Kentucky Fried Chicken with no chicken. And so it is also with the aspect of patience. Patience. Patience is a hard word in 2020. There is so much that is calling for us to wait, calling for our patience. And if you're anything like me, your patience is wearing thin. My patience is like Margaret Thatcher's patience. Margaret Thatcher once said, "I am extraordinarily patient, provided I get my own way in the end." That's me. I'm very patient as long as I get my way, at least eventually. But is that godly patience? What should we do when we don't get our way? James offers some perspective on this in chapter 5. And as we approach the text, there's a few things that I see that are ingredients for patience. Patience means suffering, anger, and self-denial. Yeah, I know I'm not going to get a lot of amens right here, but that's patience. That patience means suffering, anger, and self-denial. Patience means suffering. The idea of suffering is often equated with patience in the Bible. I mean, depending on the translation that you're using, instead of the word patience, you'll see things like long-suffering or forbearance. there's a very clear connection between patience and suffering. And in verse 10 and 11, James offers some examples of suffering and patience. He offers two. One is the prophets, and the other, Job. And scholars will note that these are the two examples that are offered because these two are the most extreme of the examples of the two types of suffering that we see in the world, moral suffering and natural suffering. Moral suffering. In the prophets, you see things like Micah, where he says, "He has told you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you, but that you act justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with your God." You see things like Amos saying, "Let justice roll down like waters, and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream." That the prophets were a response to the moral degradation of Israel. That there was idolatry and injustice that was rampant throughout, and the Lord sent the prophets to call the people back to the heart of God. And so the prophets went, and they prophesied, and they expressed the word of the Lord, and nobody listened. Can you imagine the patience that was needed to give the word of the Lord and to know nobody's going to listen? They didn't get their way. Think of Jeremiah. Jeremiah spent his life prophesying, all of his life prophesying, and they still wouldn't listen. And then the consequences of injustice and idolatry, the people were taken out of the land into exile, taken from their home, and Jeremiah went with them. He lost his home. He was exiled, and he still prophesied to them. What patience that would have had to take. James says, if you're looking for examples for patience in the face of moral suffering, look to the prophets. But then you have Job. In Job, the Lord says that he was a righteous man, yet he lost so much. Lost his children, his job, his health. He suffered greatly, and his friends came to him, saw the devastation of his life, and were trying to convince him that there was some kind of moral issue going on in his life. But there wasn't. And James commends Job as being steadfast in the experience of suffering of nature. The suffering that arises from living in a broken world, regardless of moral imperatives. So James says, this is what you see. This is what I offer you. If you want to understand patience, suffering is the arena in which it develops. Secondly, patience means anger. It means anger. And I know some of you are having a hard time taking that in because some of you are convinced that you cannot be patient but also angry, right? And then you hear people saying to you, be patient, but what they're really saying is stop caring so much. Stop caring so much, because if you stop caring so much, then you'll see it's not really that big a deal. It's not really that serious. But that is not the invitation of godly patience. Anger is not the enemy. God was angry. In all of Scripture, when you see these depictions of God in anger, it says that he's slow to anger, but it doesn't say that he never gets angry. Because the sentiment of anger is something matters to me and it's threatened. Something matters to me. And it's threatened. So you're angry that you have a dirty house because a clean house matters to you. You're angry that you can't find employment because a good job matters to you. You're angry that you can't go back into an in-person school because structure and face-to-face interaction, it matters to you. That's not the problem, caring too much. And for others of us, we like to think of ourselves as being patient, but really, we just don't care. We don't care. But indifference is not patience. James shows us what it means to utilize anger for patience. And he offers to us the farmer. We see him in verse 7. The farmer is the first example, and it's the example right after James starts off his discourse by saying, therefore be patient. Now, of course, rudimentary understanding of language, when you see a sentence that says, therefore, you know that it's trying to connect that thought to the previous thought. And so James is saying, therefore, in light of what's happening in verse 1 through 6, let me read verse 1 through 6 for you and just consider, what is the emotional tone that you're sensing? Can you sense any anger from James? Verse 1 in chapter 5, it says, come now, you rich, weep and howl for the miseries that are coming upon you. Your riches have rotted and your garments are moth-eaten. Your gold and silver have corroded and their corrosion will be evidence against you and will eat your flesh like fire. You have laid up treasure in the last days. Behold, the wages of the laborers who mowed your fields, which you kept back by fraud. They're crying out against you, and the cries of the harvesters have reached the ears of the Lord of hosts. You have lived on the earth in luxury and in self-indulgence. You have fattened your hearts in a day of slaughter. You have condemned and murdered the righteous person. He does not resist you. What's the tone that you sense? Verse 1 through 6. Because I don't sense James being whimsical. I don't sense him being lighthearted. No, I would say he's angry. That he's responding to systemic economic injustice. And he's decrying the self-indulgence. He's decrying the mistreatment of the laborers. And you sense that there's an urgency, there's an anger, there's a passion. And then he goes to verse 7 and says, how do we respond? Therefore, be patient. Be patient. Now, this isn't that type of patience that was weaponized against Martin Luther King and the civil rights leaders. Now, when you get time, go to Google and look up Letter from a Birmingham Jail. You'll see that Dr. King is addressing this notion of hollow patience and this notion of waiting that's been weaponized to be dismissive, that's weaponized to be stifling, and it's a response letter. So go look up the letter that was sent to him called, get this, A Call for Unity. Where clergy were saying to Dr. King, you just care too much about your dignity. And you see in this letter that Dr. King, he's saying, I don't want a hollow patience. And that's the similar sentiment from James. That James does not call us to be indifferent, does not call us to be dismissive, but actually James says if you're patient, you get to work. You get to work like a farmer. And we see this farmer in verse 7. And to be a farmer in general, but a farmer in particular in first century Israel, took great patience. Israel is not like America. Israel did not have rainfall at any time of the year. No, 75% of the rainfall in Israel happens on 25% of the land. Virtually 7 months of the 12 months of a year have virtually no rainfall. So it's talking about these early and latter rains. And so the farmer, he has to figure out in an agrarian culture how to sustain life. The crops matter to him, and they're constantly under threat. And he can't change the seasons, he can't change rainfall, but he does not use that to be dismissive, to be indifferent. But he engages, he gets to work because he has to care for his family, he has to cultivate the land, he has to live. And so James offers the same example to us, that if you're being patient, utilize your anger to engage your world. You can't control but you can engage. Secondly, or thirdly rather, patience means self-denial. Patience means self-denial. Here's the struggle with suffering and anger. Suffering and anger always tempts us to be self-centered. It does. It tempts us to center ourselves. I mean, think of the last time you lost your patience. You were angry, right? But it wasn't just that you were angry. You also were centered on yourself. Because the sentiment of impatience is, how dare you? How dare you make me endure your sin? And that sentiment is the case even when it's for someone else, right? There's parents that are about to send their kids back to school and all this COVID craziness. And so many parents are impatient. And the sentiment is, how dare you not care for my kids in the way that I think you should? Now, again, I'm not saying you should care less. You should care about your kids. You should care about the economy. You should care about your health. You should care about justice issues. Care about it all and more because God cares about it. But who's at the center of it? Who gets to be the judge? Because anger is not expressed in just difference of opinion. No, when you're angry, the sentiment is, I'm right and you're wrong. And you have the audacity to not see your wrongness. So when you're angry, who's really right? In verse 9, we see that James raises the concerns and calls our focus to the Lord and says, there is only one judge and you and I are not it. So it begs the question, how do we become angry but not become judgmental? How can we be angry and not be self-centered or self-righteous? I mean, isn't that the sanctification need of anger? I mean, you see this carefulness all throughout. Right in James chapter 1, you see James say, be slow to anger because the anger of man does not produce the righteousness of God. You see in Ephesians 4, Paul says, be angry, but do not sin. Even Jesus in Matthew 5 in the Sermon on the Mount, he equates anger with murder. That's how dangerous anger can be, yet anger is a natural human emotional response to felt wrongness in the world. It's part of what it means to be made in the image of God. So how can we keep from crossing the line? I think self-denial. Self-denial. Self-denial is the combative to self-righteousness. How do we accomplish this? Well, let me ask you this. When you're angry, do you think you're better than the person that you're angry with? Even just slightly, do you think you're at least a little bit morally superior? Because the truth is, if you're a Christian, you're not. You're not better. You're not more righteous. You're not more superior, even if it's your crazy kids. Even if it's your messy roommates, you're actually not better. It reminds me of a story. A prominent magazine some time ago, around the time of the World War I, they were trying to take the pulse of the culture and just saw the craziness of the times. And the magazine sent out an inquiry, very simple, and was looking for responses from people. And it simply said, what's wrong with the world? G.K. Chesterton, he responded back and gave the simplest and shortest answer. "Dear sir, I am. What's wrong with the world? I am." And Chesterton was not trying to minimize offense, was not trying to minimize the reality of being victimized of things, but what he was trying to do was trying to express that if I'm seeing the wrongness of the world and I don't understand that I'm a part of it, but actually rather an integral part of it, self-righteousness is going to grow in that. So what's wrong with my family? I am. What's wrong with my church? I am. What's wrong with my society? I am. If you are not able to understand that when you look at your neighbor, you're more like them than unlike them in their sin, self-righteousness will begin to develop. It's really why I feel like Paul said what he said in 1 Timothy 1. That Paul said, "I am the foremost of sinners, yet received mercy so that Christ might display perfect patience." Paul, who wrote the majority of the New Testament, believed that he was the worst sinner that he knew. How? Because he did not want cheap self-righteousness. He wanted the righteousness of God. And when you have cheap self-righteousness, the radar of self-righteousness is, I'm a little better than you, I'm a little better than you, I'm a little better than you, so I feel good about my righteousness. But when you have the righteousness of God, you understand that that is only accomplished by Christ and Christ alone. There is nothing in me that adds to the resume of Christ's righteousness. The only thing that I bring the righteousness of God is my sin. So Paul says, I'm the foremost of sinners. Self-denial. I like how Tim Keller defines patience. Tim Keller says, patience is grace in the face of delayed gratification. Grace in the face of delayed gratification. Self-denial. Grace, it means that there is a standard that's not being reached, yet a love that never ceases. That's what grace is. God gave us grace. And by being in Christ, we are part of extending that grace to the world. And the idea of self-denial is really something straight out of the heart of God. God is the one that practices self-denial perfectly, and he's the only one that shouldn't have to. Psalm 103 says, he does not treat us according to our sins deserve. 2 Peter 3 says, I am not slow as some count slow, but I'm being patient. Patience means self-denial. And so when I might be tempted to blast you, crush you, be passive-aggressive, or just block you, I endure with you by grace. I also like John Piper's definition of impatience. He says, impatience is a form of unbelief. It's what we begin to feel when we start to doubt the wisdom of God's timing or the goodness of God's guidance. What he's saying is, when you're impatient, you're not really upset about people or circumstances. You're really impatient with God. You're really saying, how dare you, to God. I like how Derwin Gray says, in the midst of longing for a better world, we're actually longing for God. And so the scriptures actually widen our gaze at what's actually happening here. You're upset about traffic, but you're really longing for God. You're upset about your marriage, but you're really longing for God. You're upset about school, but you're really longing for God. So James, he tries to bring our focus back to God. And he points us beyond circumstance to the coming of the Lord, to the purposes of the Lord. Because that's where we draw our patience from. And what I love about God is that he remains patient with me, even when day by day I lose patience with him. And he invites us to have his perspective with this assurance: all will be well. All will be well. In his timing, in his way, all will be well. Therefore, be patient. Let's pray. Lord, we confess that we don't trust your timing. We don't trust your guidance. We don't trust your presence. And that works its way out in all kinds of ways. One of those being, we're so angry. We're so angry because we're longing for change. Lord, would you lift our eyes and help us see that really we're longing for you, and you give that to us. And that focus is what enables us to get to work. Holy Spirit, help us to bear this fruit. In Jesus' name, amen.
Sing through days of sorrow, all is well. your divine leading on the everlasting arms. What a blessedness, what a peace of mind, leading on the everlasting arms. Leading me, safe and secure from all the alarms. Leading, leading on the everlasting arms. Oh, how sweet to walk in this pilgrim way.
Thank you so much for joining us this week. Hear now as God speaks over us his benediction. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. Amen. Hey, Christ Central, hope you're hanging in there in these trying and exhausting times. The reason that we decided to make this video was to encourage you to consider coming out for one of our communion services that we've been offering on Sunday mornings after the live stream. I can speak for myself in saying that these services have been one of the most pandemic-friendly ways to connect with the Lord and others in this season. Just to paint a little picture of what the service looks like, people arrive in their cars at 11:30 and the parking attendants will direct you to a parking space and you stay in your car the whole time. And the audio is actually broadcast into your car through your car stereo, kind of like a drive-in movie, which is pretty cool. The service lasts about 15 minutes and it's actually surprisingly family friendly for those of you with kiddos. We've had children in pajamas. We've actually had children with no shirts on, everything in between. It's just a great opportunity to be together. The service is simple. It includes prayer, confession, the Lord's Supper, obviously, and starting this week, there's going to be singing. In terms of how the Lord's Supper takes place, the ushers all wear masks and gloves and they bring these prepackaged elements to your car, similar to how they do it at many restaurants in terms of takeout. I know it doesn't sound like much, but the overwhelming feedback that we've been getting
from those who've attended is that this is such a huge gift for our COVID-weary souls. A gift to participate in the Lord's Supper for the first time in months, and a gift to see church friends, even if it's through the windows of their cars. The good news is that we have actually now figured out how to handle a pretty large crowd in the parking lot, and so since everyone's staying in the cars, we don't need registration. You can just show up, and you can be nourished through feasting on the body and blood of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, alongside with your brothers and sisters in Christ. The service starts at 11:30 a.m. each week, so why don't you come check it out? I hope to see you next Sunday.